Welcome to Critical Thought TV. I'm your host, Stuart Dambrot. Today we have Ben Goertzel, a cosmist and singularitarian. Also, the among his many other affiliations, the CEO of both Novamente and BioMind, as well as the chief science officer at Idea Holdings, as well as the chairman of the Artificial General Intelligence Society and the OpenCog Foundation. Let's start off with what you're doing in robotics and virtual worlds.
One of the projects I'm working on now, which is based in Hong Kong, in a lab at Hong Kong Polytechnic University, is focused on using OpenCog, our proto-AGI system, to control animated characters in a virtual world. The reason we chose this isn't just because video games are fun. It's because a character in a video game world provides a sort of microcosm of everything that human intelligence has to do. You have perception, you have action, you have language, you have socialization, you have to move around and find things. Pretty much everything that happens in the real world happens there, but in a simpler form.
And you, there's also then, of course, mm-hmm. I mean, I shouldn't say of course, but I saw it because I'm asking, but there's also the opportunity to have our agency in the terms of intention and goal setting within that space, rather than just being like in a first-person shooter game, reactive, based on the appearance of an enemy or a ghoul or whatever it might be. That in fact there could be a part of the whole missed goal seeking and planning aspect to the AGI entity within the virtual world. If I'm right about that.
Yeah, absolutely. The AI in the virtual world has a collection of different goals which govern much of its behavior. Some of these are basic. Say if the AI is controlling a simulated robot, it wants to find batteries which give it electricity to keep going. It wants to feel safe that no one's going to steal its batteries. Some of the goals are more generic. It wants social interaction. It wants novelty. It wants to learn new things.
Ah, this is important, right?
Yeah. So in order to pursue these goals, it goes around and figures out what to do in the world. So for example, if the AI character is walking down low on the ground and there's somewhere high up, if there's a battery up there, it may have a motivation to get up there. But also, if it's just never seen what's up there, its goal of experiencing novelty makes it think, well, maybe there's something up there I don't know about. What is it? I really want to know that. Then it tries to figure out how to get up there, and it can figure out how to cobble together objects that it can climb on to get up to the top and see that thing.
Now, that example speaks to me very strongly about more human-like or human-analogous curiosity and intelligence and motivation and relations between the perceptual systems and the motor systems, because you have to see where you're going but plan how to get there in terms of actionable physicality and all the rest of that. That's very interesting to me. The other, in terms of finding batteries, I could imagine that would be something that could be very well defined in a certain way. And it brings to mind this research I read about where there were real-world robots that had to find an energy source. And they spontaneously, on their own, learned, and they communicated using light patterns of LEDs, and they learned how to send a false message to competitive robots so that they would go in the wrong direction of the supposed energy source, so that the deceptive robots, in fact, had primary access to it. I think this is great. I think this is exactly what human beings would do in that situation. And to me, that was a profound result because they were not told or programmed in any way to do such a thing.
Mm-hmm.
I think this is great.
Yeah. I think that the virtual world has a lot to recommend it in terms of early stage prototyping of advanced AGI systems. It also has the advantage that if you were to roll out a game or a virtual world with AGI characters in it, potentially you could get millions of human players to collaborate basically in teaching your AI by playing the game.
Right. And they wouldn't even have to know that they were teaching. In fact, it's better if they don't.
They may pay you for the privilege of teaching your AI.
Right, by playing the game, they're teaching the AI.
Exactly.
That's great. That's terrific.
So I think that's important. On the other hand, I do suspect there's an ingredient that you can only get from actual physical robots. In other words, the video game worlds and the virtual worlds have a very limited richness of perceptual data and of motor action affordances compared to what you get in this everyday world we live in. It's not really a fundamental in principle point, because I think you could build in principle a simulation world that was incredibly richly detailed. But in practice, that's not what we have now. The video game worlds, I mean, they don't have fabrics. They don't have hair. They don't have complex fluid dynamics. There's no peanut butter. There's no clay. If you think about what little kids like to play with, an awful lot of it, it's not just blocks, right? An awful lot of what little kids like to do is learning from all these different materials and substances and their interactions.
Right, and the malleability of clay, and the ability to not just have tactile feedback, but the sensation of a surface and all of that, that's critical. It also reminds me, I wanted to ask you about this because it just occurred to me. Lakoff, George Lakoff, and the whole world of metaphor. He does hold that in his parlance, the conceptual metaphor is something that is based on a primary metaphor, and a primary metaphor is something that is embodied knowledge that results from interaction with the environment in a prelingual state. So that being the case, it just occurred to me that what you're talking about, once especially embodied in the real world, could lead at some point to the emergence of metaphorical language capability in an AGI, and I was wondering what you thought about that proposition.
Absolutely. An awful lot of our language is indirectly and implicitly based on our physical embodiment. We use metaphors like, you know, he pointed out that what he's pointing may be some completely abstract mathematical thing, but we still say he pointed out. And like, well, he was on the verge of doing this.
On the verge, right. The road ahead.
Yeah.
Referring to the future. And people actually lean forward.
He backpedaled on his statement.
Yeah, exactly. Right.
I mean, there's an endless number of spatial, temporal, physical metaphors that are embedded in our language as well as in our abstract thinking.
Very good. Yeah, very good.
I wouldn't go so far as to say that you could never make a human level AGI without a robot body to interact in the world. I think you could do it other ways, but to me that's the most straightforward way. But there is a dilemma there as an AGI developer. On the one hand, dealing with robots is a real pain right now. Right. They never quite work right. The robot technology we have today is quite crude and primitive.
And they fall over and break, as you once told me as well. That's an issue.
On the other hand, using the robotic embodiment, in principle, gives you so much more in terms of integration of perception, action, cognition, language, and in terms of, as you said, understanding linguistic structure in terms of your embodied experience.
And in terms of the affordances you mentioned as well after Gibsonian ecological psychology, that those are evolutionarily determined.
Yeah.
They arise naturally because of the interaction over time, but time can be manipulated, and temporality can be manipulated in a virtual world, so it can be sped up, but it's based even in that virtual or real world on interaction, real world interaction.
But fortunately, robotics technology is advancing pretty fast. I've been talking a lot with two outstanding roboticists, David Hansen, who's building the Hansen Robokind, which is a commercial humanoid robot about this tall with a very emotionally expressive robot face. And then Mark Tilden, who's based in Hong Kong, who is the mastermind of Huawei, which made the Robo Sapien robot, which doesn't break when it falls down the stairs. And Interestingly, Hansen's robot is also manufactured by Jetta, based in Hong Kong. Oh. So we've got a sort of robo AI community
developing
there with Western AI and robotics design guys basically working with the Chinese robot manufacturers across the border in China, because China is really the only place now that knows how to make complex robots at scale and low cost.
Oh, that's very interesting. Yeah.
So I think that in the next few years, as robotics technology gets better and better, it's going to become more and more viable for AI and AGI researchers to work with robots. And I think that that's very positive.
Especially if we want to reach DARPA's goal of having autonomous AGI robotic armies by 2050.
Well, there you go.
Right.
Yeah, one interesting example of robot technology that I've just seen recently, there are robot fingertips.
Quite right.
That's manufactured by a company called Syntouch.
Yes, they even have fingerprints allow them to have
minute sensations.
They're
pressure sensitive, temperature sensitive, and heat sensitive.
And they're able to curl with many degrees of freedom around
movement
round
sensitive.
Objects.
So these fingertips can distinguish things based on touch as well as based on...
And many times better than a human can in terms of differentiating
in some cases,
what the surface
but
of that object is.
If you look
is
at
like.
A problem like picking up this cup, I mean, doing that by vision only is going to be pretty annoying, right? I would rather close my eyes and pick up the cup with touch only than do it by vision only.
Right.
But we really do it by a combination, and we do many things using that combination. And the synergy between vision and touch, I think, is cognitively important in terms of how we understand the world, because vision is sort of at a distance. It's almost a third-person view of things.
Right.
Touch is very intimate. I mean, that whatever you touch becomes almost like a part of you, very briefly.
And audition is somewhere in the middle. We know we don't have to. We can hear from the sound that it's on the table surface.
Yeah.
All right, but we're holding it, so it's linked to that sense modality. But we don't have to use vision.
Audition lets us sense movement in a very direct way, which is a unique contribution of audition. If you want to hear whether someone's coming toward you or away from you, you can hear that and you can sense it quite readily, whereas telling it by vision is a bit dodgier sometimes and then less precise. So each of the senses contributes a different thing conceptually. We integrate them all, that helps us understand the world and understand ourselves conceptually. As robotics technology advances, we're getting further and further toward the point where AGI systems can build a similar conceptual understanding to what people have. And I think this understanding that you can build an AGI mind through its robot embodiment can be helpful for many AI tasks that wouldn't seem to rely on robotics. I've been doing a lot of work applying AI to analyzing genetics data. We're looking at genetics data from long-lived flies that live 4 or 5 times as long as normal people, produced by selective breeding over 30 years. We're applying AI technology to genetic data from long-lived people, looking at healthy people age 80 over versus matched controls who are age 80 or over but not healthy, trying to understand the genetic underpinnings of longevity and age-associated disease. Now, on the face of it, this would seem to have nothing at all to do with little robots walking around. It seems like you're just crunching genetics data. But here's the thing. Most of the information you need to interpret the genetics data is in research papers. Now, how can the AI understand all these research papers? Well, the AI can understand these research papers if it could read. You're right back to the language understanding problem, and you're back to the fact that the metaphors and expressions used in research papers are largely drawn from embodied experience.
Ah, quite right.
To take another point, reading papers and analyzing data isn't all you need to do to understand longevity. You need to design new experiments. Right now, humans design experiments. AI is a tool that we help to analyze the data generated by the experiments.
And AGI could design experiments.
And AGI could design experiments, but the way that we design experiments, even if they're quite abstract experiments using sequencers and gene expression technology, the way we design biology experiments is heavily conditioned by what we do manipulating physical objects in the everyday world. Any preschool teacher will tell you that the kids are learning to be little scientists. They're learning to do experiments as they play with stuff. As you cook, you're learning to do experiments. The intuition that scientists have for how to design experiments partly comes from their abstract study of the scientific method, and partly comes from tinkering, from their everyday life experience fiddling with stuff. Robotic embodiment will not only help AIs learn to be better service robots or manufacturing robots, it will give AIs an intuition for how to fiddle around, tinker, and experiment with things, which will then help the AI to do better genetics experiments, design better biomedical experiments in general.
Thank you so much. That's great stuff. Thank you very much.